What's up, everybody? This is Takai, and welcome to Sugoi Saturdays. And, yeah, it's going to be a good one this week, actually. I think we're going to have a lot of fun. But first, let's introduce our guests this month. First off, it's the raging Canadian himself, Coolidger!
Konbanwa, motherfuckers.
And then always my partner in crime on Twitter for shitposting, my boy Lux.
Do-do-do, boys.
And then my longtime lover, Roger Smith 2004.
Yo, yo, yo.
That escalated real fast.
Since yeah, 2004.
Really. Yeah, that's why he's got the 2004. It's to remember our first
Yeah,
first
clearly
meeting.
That's one-sided because you don't have the 2004.
Yeah.
Ouch.
Well, you know, yeah. I live in the past. He's always looking forward.
Yeah, I'm just picturing future, that baby. I Love Amelia scene where Takai is just talking about someone else. And Roger Smith is just Rem.
I love Amelia.
Damn.
Amelia. Shit. Yeah. So as everybody knows, thanks to Funimation spamming the shit out of it on your social networks, your name has been in theaters for the past week, and I think it's going to continue this week, I think, because they did post sometime in, yesterday or the day before, and I think it's still going to be in theaters this weekend as well. I don't know how long it's going, but the worldwide phenomenon, Your Name, has been in theaters, and we have all seen it.
Woo!
So we're going to talk about it.
Or as I like to call it, Kimi Ni Ni Ni.
Yeah. Kiwi. Kiwi Meenie. Of course, we're going to have spoilers for this, so if you have not seen Your Name, click away now, or forever hold your peace.
Also, you should. Because it's pretty good, spoiler alert.
Yeah, and if Coolidger says it, then it's gotta be true. So, okay. So yeah, we all saw Your Name. So first off, I actually want to hear everybody how you saw it. Did you see it subbed, or did you see it dubbed?
I saw it subbed.
Yeah, I saw it subbed. We only got the fucking, like, front row, because we went as the movie was starting, so the five of us had to sit on the bottom row and somehow look up at the screen, which was hard enough, and then read subtitles, but we made it work.
Wow. Okay. And Roger?
I watched the sub showing, but I had pretty style on seats. I don't know why there was, like, no one in my row, which was so weird, because, like, it was the ideal way to view the movie, because the subs are at the very bottom, at very top of the screen. So it seemed weird to sit all the way in the front. You'd want to be, like, upper middle.
Yeah, rub it in.
Well, guys, did you hear that guy talk? I think that's Roger Smith 2004. Bro, no, we gotta go. He's too cool. We can't sit in the same row. Bro, no, I want to sit behind him.
I did, like, the seats were so low that, like, a row below would just be the top of someone's head, so I did accidentally whack someone in the head.
Oh.
During nice. The movie.
And now they know exactly who did it. If they're watching their podcast today, we're sorry that you got smacked upside the head.
It's a good old Kimi no Na whack.
Nice. I'm the black sheep. I saw it dubbed. So
well, boo.
Fuck
up,
I mean, you're the
hey,
dub guy.
The dub was great. The dub was actually really great.
Yeah, no, I don't doubt it.
You know, and I for the sub, I feel like, you know, you've seen one sub, you've seen them all. So,
oh,
you know, ouch.
Yeah, you haven't been taking Japanese lessons, so.
Fight me, son.
All the voices sound different when you understand.
Hey, I know enough Japanese that I can distinguish.
Yeah, that your
I'm
name
just talking
is expensive.
Shit. I'm just talking shit. Another thing before we actually talk about the movie, how were your theaters? Like, for example, mine, I would say, was over half filled, and my audience was really rowdy, and they loved it. Lots and lots of laughs in the first time I saw it. The second time wasn't as many people, and not nearly as many people laughed. So the first time was a lot more fun to see it.
I saw it the third day it was out, so there are not actually a lot of people there, and maybe that has to do with the fact that I watched it subbed, and there were like three other showings for it on that day. But yeah, it was almost there was maybe like 20 people in the theater.
Opening night. First showing, packed theater. We only had the front row open for the five of us despite reserving our tickets. But yeah, definitely having a full theater was a lot of fun too, because when you get that many people, generally there's more like collective laughs and collective sighs and stuff. And I think like the last 20 minutes there was a collective, everybody held their breath. It felt like when that moment at the very end, and I won't say what it is quite yet, but everybody knows what it is, when that finally happened and they did talk, everybody, you kind of like heard a collective sigh among the theater. It was just like okay.
Roger?
My crowd wasn't as into it. It was mostly felt, I'd say. But yeah, like, I know during the they were pretty receptive of the ending, but I don't recall too much, like, in terms of, like, crowd reactions. A few laughs here and there.
Yeah, pretty much every boob grab got a laugh.
Yes.
Yeah. I'd like to hear that from all of you, because we're all from different parts of the country. Me and Lux being in the Midwest, Coolidger actually being in Canada, and then Roger actually in the East Coast. So it's definitely cool to hear how many people were in there, what kind of reactions you got. But it's good to hear that it seems like a lot of us had a majority that it was filled fairly well. More than most people probably expect for an anime film.
The only other time I see that many weebs gathered in one place is conventions.
Hell yeah. So, Your Name, as we all know, is a global phenomenon, and it is now the number one most money receiving, I don't know how to talk, highest grossing anime film ever. So, with that in mind, and it being number one on my anime list, we all know how important that is, what are your guys' thoughts on Makoto Shinkai's Your Name?
Alright, I feel like we should keep this in order, Lux, if you want to go.
Okay, knowing that it was the highest grossing film, and that is number one on my anime list, I didn't want to hype myself for it, like, at all. Because the last time I got hyped for something, it was for Your Lie in April, which is now my least favorite anime, so never again. I went into the movie thinking, yeah, I'm going to give this a strong 6. That's going to be just fine. And I was actually pleasantly surprised. Like, I was expecting it to be in a spectacle for animation, and it is, but it also actually tells a pretty good story. Like, not a super good one, not like an overwhelming one, but, you know, it has some good twists, it has, like, you know, decent characters, a nice concept. It's, I would say for what it is, it's handled pretty well.
Yeah.
Okay.
I've seen a couple of Shinkai's films before, and, like, his animation work is obviously always stellar, and we all knew that, like, anime-wise, it was gonna be beautiful. I don't think it was as good as Garden of Words from an animation perspective, but you also have to consider that Garden of Words was, like, a 45-minute movie, and Your Name was a full, like, 2 hours just about, so there's definitely more ground to cover. As far as, like, story goes, I agree with Lux. Like, I went into it ready to bash the shit out of it, because that's usually my job when it comes to these things. And I came away, like, you know, I laughed at the fun parts, and there were good emotional moments late in the movie. So I certainly thought it somewhat lived up to its hype. I don't know if it, like, is the best anime movie or the best anime anything I've seen, period, but it's certainly a very good watch. Not without flaw, but I liked it for the most part.
Sure.
Oh, I do want to mention, this was my first Shinkai film.
Really? Okay.
Although, since then, I have watched 5 Centimeters and Garden of Words.
Well, when I went into the movie, I went in with the expectation that I'd think it's pretty alright, and I came out thinking that it was pretty alright. I feel like there were a few missed opportunities here and there, but the story was rather interesting, and it was a nice throwback to, like, a lot of early 2000s anime, particularly Shinkai's earlier work in Voices of a Distant Star, and sort of, it feels within that kind of early 2000s anime trend, and it was nice to see a little callback to that, because I wasn't expecting that.
Nice. The only Shinkai films that I had seen prior was Garden of Words, and I really actually enjoyed that one. I from what I've read, that it's kind of split. Some people really like it, some people don't. And then I saw it aired on Toonami, and it was Children Who Chase Lost Voices. I believe that's his.
Yeah.
I was not very impressed with that one. So coming into this, I kind of thought, I'm like, okay, this guy is much more of a visual guy more than he is a storyteller. And, you know, leading up to this point, I knew how, you know, hyped up it was and how all these commenters that people had either illegally, you know, downloaded it and saw it or were actually living in Japan and saw it or other parts of the world, you know, and saying how amazing it was. I just kind of went in. I'm like, all right, I have to see this. I really want to. I'm really curious as to why, you know, people hold it in such high regard. So I went in there. Sat down, and my first impression was, wow, I'm surprised how funny this movie is. I thought this was going to be super serial.
Yeah.
But it was actually really, really funny at first, you know, especially with all the boob grabbing and, you know, crotch grabbing and the whole montage scene of them trying to live their lives. I was very surprised, I would say, at first when I watched it, but then I, you know, it developed, and I really think it was an excellent movie. I originally rated it 10 out of 10, but that was kind of, you know, just getting out of the theater. But when I really sit and think about it, I don't know if it's actually worth a 10. I think it's an excellent movie, an excellent story, has an absolutely breathtaking visuals, but I just don't know if I can give it a 10. Just because, it kind of lacked that, like that one thing that kind of separates it from everybody else. You know, again, it had a great twist. But, you know, for everybody saying it's just the best film of all time, again, I just feel like it lacks that one thing that gives it that extra oomph. You know, now that I think about it in hindsight. And I did see the movie twice, so I was able to, you know, watch it two different ways. More from an entertainment perspective, and then the second time, more of a critical perspective.
Now, realistically, he watched the second time upside down like Spider-Man. That's what he means when he says he watched it twice.
Spider-Man, yeah, that's... I did decide to see it dubbed twice because I just didn't feel like reading, you know. I'm not really in the mood to listen to Watashi wa Your Name Des.
Ugh,
read.
Because that's exactly what they said.
It's the worst. What'd you say?
That's exactly what they said in the movie. How do you know?
I've been around the block when it comes to anime. So, yeah, let's just get right into spoiler territories. What did everybody think of the twist?
Which twist? The fact that there was a 3-year time gap between them?
Basically. I mean, that is the twist.
That was pretty good, honestly. Like, the whole, like, it takes a concept that's been done before, the whole switching bodies thing. Like, we've seen a ton of Hollywood movies do that. Just think of, like, Freaky Friday. So, that wasn't that different. But then, having them, like, be in very different parts of the world, like very, like generally when these movies happen, it's like a direct switch and the two people are close to each other. Having these two people who don't know each other and who live like very different lives in very different parts of Japan was interesting in itself, and I thought that was the only twist. So I was actually not expecting it to also include a 3-year time skip. And I know there was a couple of hints at different points in the movies, which one of my friends noticed. He did pick up on some stuff and he actually kind of guessed the twist but didn't spoil it. But yeah, it did a pretty good job of, like, keeping it twisty, but also giving enough hints that people can guess, and I thought it was well handled.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how
I just wanted to mention how he, you know, a few hints. It was, like, the very first scene in the movie, which is that, you know, red meteor falling, which I just kind of took at face value at first, was just, oh, here's the meteor that everybody's looking at and talking about. You know, that's how I took it. But then when I saw it the second time, I'm like, oh, shit. That's, you know, that's the meteor crash right there.
Mm-hmm.
So go on, Fennekin.
I'm not sure how I feel about the 3-year gap, actually. I just feel like that's something that they would have found out about, like, what was the main character's name? I forgot the guy's name.
Taki.
Oh.
Yeah,
I feel like they, before he actually found out that the town is completely destroyed, that there would be some way of knowing that they're going back to different time periods. I don't know. It was kind of confusing. I might have to watch it again to really wrap my head around all of it, but I don't know. It was interesting.
See, Yeah, and I get what you're saying, because after reading some comments and whatnot, a lot of people were calling out what they considered plot holes, like how they didn't search where they came from and whatnot, and if they, you know, did a simple maybe Google search or something, or perhaps even like the calendar dates, you know, should have been different. Like there should have been enough hints for the characters to realize that they were living in a different, you know, two different times. So that's what I read. So, and it, I think that is fair criticism, that, you know, kids in 20, you know, millennials, 2013 to 2017, whatever, the first thing, not one of the first thing, but maybe one of the things they might have began with was a Google search or something, you know?
Yeah, like, who is this, and at one point they would have realized, inhabiting my body, I better check that he doesn't have a criminal record.
Yeah, or, you know, whatever. I mean, eventually they would have saw the difference in dates, but, so it's a fair criticism, but just one of those things I think a lot of people just kind of shrug off.
I see where both sides are coming from, because, like, you also have to consider that these are, like, high school teenagers. You know, that's not always going to be the first thing that they think about, and it's weird that I'm using this argument, because I've had this argument used against me so many times when I, like, criticize teenage characters for doing stupid things, but, like, I can see where that comes from, and what was the other thing I was going to say? I don't remember. You know what? Just get back to me. I'll probably have a second half of this argument in a second.
Yeah, the guy's like, well, I've got a pair of tits now, so who cares? You know, maybe that's why he, you know, he didn't really think about it.
I mean, I at least acknowledge that the main focus of the two characters is that they're just trying to kind of get through the day as different people. I understand that's more important to them than really figuring out all of the information about what's going on. I just still think it's just, I don't know, I think it just would have been kind of obvious at some point.
Also, I'm pretty sure he had her phone number, because there's a point when she stops responding and he tries to call her a couple times. Why the fuck did you wait so long to try and call her? I don't get it.
I don't know, maybe he wanted her to get out of his life as soon as possible and vice versa. I don't know.
Didn't get that impression, but okay.
I know, I'm just kind of spitballing ideas. I don't know really what they were thinking.
Yeah.
Roger?
Yeah, the phone number thing actually came up, like, in terms of, like, I was thinking, you know, why don't they text each other?
Yeah.
Like,
no, they can only leave messages through their diary or something.
Yeah.
I think maybe it's because she was living out, like he said in the movie, she was living out in the boonies, and maybe he just thought, maybe my phone can't reach that far. Maybe they don't have a cellular tower, or, you know. That's the only thing I can think of.
That could be true. In terms of the twist, though, I actually thought it was quite interesting, because I do wonder if Shinkai was trying to do a commentary on a Fukushima incident with this movie. Oh, because, keep in mind,
are you talking about the 2011?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Because, 3/11. Keep in mind, there's an environmental message in the film, and it happens roughly around the same time, 2012, 2013, give or take. That's like a couple of years. And it's still relevant, so it makes sense to me.
And, yeah, the town did partially flood because of the lake, you know, next to it. So I can see it. I guess another aspect is, what did you think of the characters themselves? Like, I thought Mizuha was Sugoi Kawaii. I just wanted to use the word Sugoi.
There you go. Yeah, Sugoi Saturday's plug. Word
hey,
of the day,
everybody.
Here we go.
Thanks for listening, everyone. Hachicha. See you next month.
Hachicha. All right. So, yes, what did you guys think?
I thought the characters were just passable.
Yeah, no, I don't think there was any, like, particular standout character in this movie, but I also don't think there was any, like, character that I didn't think belonged or was, like, a weak link. I think all the characters felt like they fit their roles pretty well, and I can't really say much one way or the other about them.
Yeah, they're good. They're just good pieces for the story.
Yeah.
They were deep enough, like, because they didn't really need to go that deep, because they were just teenagers, you know? And usually love stories don't get too deep in characters anyway.
I actually think they made a pretty interesting choice with the characterization, where in most films, you know, they'll focus and they'll close in on a specific character. But here, what they did was they had the two characters, but they closed in on their specific personality traits by showing how they act in another person's body. So You'll have, like...
That's true.
You'll have one character be in another character's body, and you'll see how these characters are in their own bodies as a result through that.
Two characterizations at once. Like, you get the characterization of the character who's inhabiting the body, but based on how everyone around them is reacting, you can also get a sense of how that actual, like, the other person is, the person whose body that is.
Yeah, it's interesting stuff, though. It can be kind of disorienting, because sometimes, like, if you're trying to talk about the film for memory, you have to remember, oh wait, was he in her body at that point? Like, a lot of times it's very apparent, but, like, sometimes, you know, it can be a little difficult to
remember. Taki usually blushes more if it's Mitsuha, and, you know, Mitsuha usually has a different hairstyle if it's Taki inside her. So they did kind of give some visual hints, just a little bit, and same with their body language. I believe, but yeah, I do agree. You kind of had to figure out for yourself who was who.
Yeah, which I loved the translation joke at the beginning too, and I'm glad that carried over. The whole, like, he's talking to his friends on the roof, and he introduces himself as, like, Watashi, which is generally looked at as more feminine way, and so he says that, and his two guy friends are like, what? And then at some point, he goes to Boku, which is, like, a kid's way of introducing themselves, and then he finally gets it right, and they both just kind of nod. They're like, yep.
How did they do that for the dub?
He's like, well, a girl. And they're like, huh? And she's like, a gal? And they're like, what? And then she finally goes, a guy. You know, a guy, something you, there's some, I can't remember, something about, there. It's always a party living in Tokyo. It's always,
It doesn't sound so like it translated.
So I guess
well.
They kind of made it a, yeah, it kind of, what it sounds like to me is that they, kind of made it like, you know, well, where were you today? Oh, I was hanging out with a girl. And they're like, what? You were hanging out with a girl? Kind of joke. That's what at least came to me, you know. And to me, I mean, it worked fine for me. It makes sense because they, again, do that joke later with him and his fellow staff at the restaurant. So, you know, it made sense to me.
Okay.
So despite it not translating well, it still makes sense. And, Now that you explain it in the subway, that also makes sense. I guess there is one thing that I do want to mention, and I missed it during my second viewing, and I meant to look. So you know how Miss Okudera has a ring on her hand at the end?
Yeah.
I tried to look because it was a scene right before that. He's in the coffee shop with his two friends. I tried to look to see if the guy with the glasses, Tsukasa, had a ring on his finger. Because it seemed to me like they hit it off fairly well on their, you know, little journey. Because they spent a lot of time together while Taki was researching stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know if anybody else looked at all. But I was just curious to see who she was engaged to.
No, I
didn't. Maybe it was
really.
Maybe it was just some random character. I don't know. That's just one thing I wanted to bring up to see if, you know, it was actually him or not.
Yeah, I didn't look for it.
So yeah, next time, I guess, if you see the movie, let me know.
Yeah, I'll watch the movie just for that, just so, like, I'll ignore the rest of the movie, and I'll just focus when that scene comes on and just pinpoint my vision.
Just fast forward. Character-wise, I thought it was all right. Got quite a few laughs out of me, way more than I thought I was going to get, so...
Yeah. I thought the side cast could have been a little stronger. I feel like Taki's side characters were a little less interesting.
Yeah
Tsukasa and, yeah.
Like, I didn't feel the romance really went that far.
I think the main reason they did, like, they focused more on building Tom, what's her name's, two best friends versus Taki's is mainly because... That's kind of where the big point of the plot takes place when they're trying to prevent the thing from hitting. And so I feel like they were more integral to actually, like, what was going on. The big event versus the actual two characters switching bodies. So I think that they kind of built them more for that reason.
Yeah, no, structurally it makes sense. I mean, this is almost a 2-hour film. There's only so much you can fit.
Yeah.
To counterbalance
those two friends, I think Miss Okudera, you know, that's what they called her in the film. I don't know what her first name is. I think she was strong enough. You know, we got to see a lot of her personality and things like that. So, in my opinion, it kind of balanced out a little bit. His two boy, you know, friends that were boys, obviously didn't get a lot of time as compared to the other two from whatever town they were living in.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I think they just played more of a stronger role because they were doing stuff that was a bit more interesting. You know, they were hacking into stuff and they were.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. They were more integral into the plot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whereas the stuff that like, whereas the stuff with Miss Okudera was a bit more natural and a bit more, you know, realistic, I'd say.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, and the guy in the village, the one with the shaved head, that was Kyle Hebert, by the way, if anybody knew. So to me, it was kind of funny, just a little bit, especially growing up with Gohan and whatnot.
Oh.
And the Dragon Ball Z announcer. I guess as for, you know, that's probably a good talking point would be the dubcast itself. The guy who did Taki did just fine. I'm not too thrilled on. Stephanie Shea being Mitsuha. I think they probably could have gone with a better actress in terms of how she sounded. Because what was odd is that I saw that Stephanie Shea was the voice director for the film itself. And I'm like, okay, so she's the voice director and the main girl? What's going on here? Honestly, I probably would have rather cast Jeremy Lee, if anyone knows her at all from anything, like Lucy from Fairy Tail or if anyone's playing Persona, she's Makoto. I would have rather grabbed her just because Stephanie Shea to me sound, you know, she's kind of hit that point where she's been enough stuff where, you know, it's just a 40-year-old woman trying to be a kid, you know. But Kyle Hebert obviously also sounds like an older man even when he tries to play a kid. But in all honesty, he was the comedy relief and I think he fit well. Just kind of wanted to throw my dub thoughts out there for anybody.
It's interesting, though, because the dub is done by NYAV Post.
Really?
And I believe Stephanie Shea and Michael Center Niklaus, who played Taki, run that studio. So that is kind of suspicious.
Really?
Huh. That they both get the main leads. So,
I had no idea, and so that's how you pronounce his last name.
Yeah,
that's why I just said Taki's voice actor. That last name is scary.
That's
interesting.
Taki
I did
more.
Not know that. Yeah, I always think of the Mexican snack when they say Taki. If anyone
knows.
Yeah, like there's like a chip called like Takis or, yeah, it's just called Takis. Yeah, and they're just rolled up. You know, so kind of like a taquito.
Oh.
So that's what I think of. Sorry to get off track a little bit, but so I kind of hate that name just a little bit.
I'm terrible at remembering character names.
Me too.
And I also think it was clever, actually, now that I think about it, was his wrist, where he had that thing on his wrist from Mitsuha. I actually didn't realize that until the end of the movie when they revealed it, you know, just because I always thought Mitsuha's thing was just straight up red and didn't have, you know, a gradient of colors in it, like Taki's. But that was a good I can't remember the theater term for it. Something like someone's gun.
Chekhov's gun.
Yeah. That's a good one. Like that was a good device.
Yeah, where in every single piece of the film later becomes integral in some way. Yes.
Yeah, it has to be like it has to appear in the first act for it to be used in the, you know, final act or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I sort of paid attention in theater class. Come on now. So, I guess, is there anything else anyone can think of that you'd like to discuss about the movie?
The ending.
We should talk about the art.
You can do art first. We'll end with the
ending. We should do the ending first, because we've been talking about the story already.
Okay, fair.
Yeah.
Specifically, the time skip ending I kind of want to talk about, because I felt like the reason it didn't get a 10 for me was the last 20 minutes of the film is kind of where I felt a little iffier about it, because Makoto Shinkai, as we've seen a couple of his films, has kind of developed a style, and particularly with his endings, they generally end in, like, this love that cannot be
Melancholy, yeah.
Not even melancholy, it's just, like, it's a forbidden love, if you will. Like, it's you know, Garden of Words, it was the teacher and the student. They can't be together. And then 5 centimeters was obviously, like, the distance for a while, and then... So his stories generally end with, like, the two people not ending up together. And so it feels like the last 20 minutes of this film, he kind of takes that concept and almost drags it out a little too much. Like, he's... It feels like a troll, if you will. Because I know they like, pass each other on the trains, and it looks like they're about to talk, and then they don't talk. And this is why everybody in the theater, I think, was holding their breath. It's more... Is Shinkai going to end with one of his typical they don't end up together? And then they look like they're about to talk again, and then they pass each other again. And it felt like he kind of played with that concept a little bit too much.
See, my question is, now that you mentioned that, is Mitsuha a few years older than
she's three
than
years older. I think he is 21 at the film's end, and she is 24.
Okay, nice.
Which is entirely reasonable anyway, so...
Yeah. And I guess it makes you wonder, especially with how time works and whatnot, don't you think... I mean, I guess, you know, he did previously establish that she did forget now that I really think about it. It's like, if she did really change things, wouldn't she meet him up at that mountain? But now that I think about it, obviously they began to forget almost immediately after the magic hour scene, you know?
Look at the sky, it's magic hour. Sorry, I had to do that.
It's a great anime. It's a great anime. It's okay.
Every time someone says magic hour, I can't not do that. Fucking Amagi. But yeah, it does feel like the whole magical aspect kind of wears off at that point. And like, they're very clearly tied by like the red string of fate, as the hairband symbolizes. And so I feel like with that getting passed back, they kind of forget all the... Because that's kind of how it's supposed to be. He manages to save her in the time, like, that the magic is still going on, per se. And then, at that point, you're not supposed to, like, remember or know. And that's usually how these movies kind of go. And then we get that big tease of, like, are they going to remember each other? And I am glad that they don't end up, like, cheaping out and having them, like, look at each other and just recall everything. They look at each other and they can kind of, like, sense that they want to talk to each other, that they're what they've been searching for. But they don't, like, remember everything. They just kind of... hit it off seemingly at the end, and then it just kind of ends there.
See, and that'll be my final question for the discussion, so we'll wait on that and we can move on to art. Lux, go ahead.
Yeah, so I mean, again, I expected this to be a spectacle, and it definitely, this is probably, I wouldn't say this is the best looking Shinkai film. I actually think that goes to Garden of Words, and my reasoning for that is because Your Name is probably the most polished anime film, but I actually think that the backgrounds, at least some of them, like when they're in buildings or in the subway, I actually think they were like so advanced and so on such a level of detail that I don't think the character art quite matched up to it. It felt a little inconsistent there, which, I mean, I don't even know if that's really a complaint, because that's literally,
I mean, that's
saying something.
I have about Handshakers.
I mean...
I mean, that's literally Handshakers.
Yep, 10 out of 10. I mean, I'm literally saying, like, something was just so good that it just, you know, everything else, even though it is good, just isn't quite on that same level. But it is quite an amazing film.
No, I agree with the animation. Like, it's... I agree with you that it's not as polished as Garden of Words from an animation standpoint. It's not.
No, it's more polished than Garden of Words, but I think Garden of Words is just more consistent.
Yeah. Yes, because, like, I said this at the beginning, too, but Garden of Words is, like, half the runtime and then some of Your Name, so it's also, like, you know, you have to take that into consideration.
Yeah.
I do think Garden of Words was a more complete animation. Like, almost everything about Garden of Words was beautiful, whereas Your Name, for some of these slower scenes, like, particularly in the montages, they definitely took a little bit of a lapse with character models. I noticed, like, there were some facial expressions at some point, a couple points in the movie. It didn't happen often, but at a couple points where they went for the very, like, basic character animation face that you would expect from a TV series, not a movie. Which I don't blame them for, because the movie is so well animated, they can take a few breaks here and there. It didn't take away from the overall film, because it was during scenes that don't need beautiful animation anyway. But they're definitely still there.
Yeah, the the one scene that I can think of that had his face like that was when he was in the truck looking at the map.
Mm-hmm.
If you remember that, driving to the shrine right before he gets dropped off. Taki had like the weirdest face. I'm like, oh man, they need to clean that up. So I definitely hear
and
what
you're
saying.
And there's a scene on the roof where it was like a second or two, but it was noticeable enough that I caught that as well.
Yeah.
I have to give the film props, though. The CG actually wasn't too bad, because when they did have CG, they'd like blur the background so you don't really notice it. And you know, that was my main complaint with The Boy and the Beast when I saw that, which is Hosoda's latest film.
Oh yeah.
And that had a ton of CG and like a ton of really bad CG. And you'd notice like the frame rate dropping sometimes.
Oh boy.
So the visual prowess in this film, especially in terms of 3D CG modeling, was far more polished.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, it was excellent. Yeah, I 100% agree. I think this was a really gorgeous film, and I think that's kind of what you get when it comes to Shinkai's work. That's always a visual treat, and I think he is a much more visual director than he is a story kind of guy.
Yep.
But I really enjoyed it. I thought the city, like Lux said, looked phenomenal. It was extremely intricate in its detail, and I can understand more simpler character designs, and it's okay. But even still, I thought Mitsuha's character design was just freaking adorable.
Oh, no.
I loved her hairstyle.
The character designs in general were, like, fine. Like, they were really well-animated characters. I was just talking about a couple of lapses where they very clearly just took a break.
Sure. Yeah, no. I did see a few examples, so I agree. Yeah, and there was even some, facial expressions at some point that I thought were amazingly animated. Like, when Taki was up on the mountain, and he realized something. I can't exactly remember the scene, but I do specifically remember a time where he had this very realistic animated face, and I thought it was outstanding. I do think it was just wonderful, but it's really difficult to top Garden of Words. Garden of Words was breathtaking.
Yeah.
And
I mean, that's what
I guess
the animation was kind of what sold me on this film, too, because before I even knew who was attached to it, and before the movie came out, I saw a trailer, and like I didn't know anything about it, and I think I passed the trailer around because I was sold just based on the animation. I didn't know what it was about and who was attached to it, but I was immediately like open to watching it because it, even that 2-minute trailer was just beautiful.
Mm-hmm. So the last thing I want to talk about before my final question is how did everybody like the music by Rad Wimps?
That was cool.
I thought it was really good.
My version, the English dub version, I think, I don't know about the subbed, but my version had English lyrics. The guy was singing in English.
No, yeah, we had a couple of English songs in there, too.
Yeah.
Pretty sure.
In the Japanese one, it was all Japanese, but I've heard the English version of Zen Zen Zens, which is the main theme of the movie, and I'm surprised by the lack of English. I'm kind of impressed.
You should actually listen to Dream Lantern, which is the opening movie song. Oh man, it's excellent in English. I'm very surprised. At first, I thought to myself, wait a second, is this an English band? But then I'm like, there's no way with the name Rad Wimps and whatnot. This has got to be it. And then I eventually started to hear a little bit of iffy English grammar and whatnot. To notice that I'm like, yeah, this is definitely a Japanese band. But music was excellent. Really, really enjoyed it, especially in the montages. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm going to try getting into this band because to me, they sound a lot like a combination of Bump of Chicken and Asian Kung Fu Generation, which are two really popular alternative rock bands.
Terrific bands, yeah. The music is on iTunes if anybody's interested, by the way.
Plug, plug, plug.
Yeah, Rad Wimps. My final question, which I'm really excited to hear everybody's answer. So at the very end of the movie, we know that they saw each other, and they did start to cry when they saw each other, and they couldn't figure out why. Do you think they will actually? Do you think they remembered anything at all, if anything?
No. I don't think that they remembered, but I also... because for the way they were crying, it looked like they were crying not because, like, of something they remembered. It looked like they were crying and kind of confused as to why they're crying. Like, their body was just reacting that way when they saw each other.
Mm-hmm. Lux?
I don't know. To me, it doesn't really matter if they remember it or not. I just think it's nice that they kind of meet again in the future, and that's just all that really matters.
Okay. Roger?
I'd like to believe that as long as that memory with the string of fate is not present, that they don't remember. It's something not really remembered, just felt.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Personally, I'm more of a optimist when it comes to something like this. I guess because near the end of the movie when he was talking to, or when he or she, I can't remember which one, was talking to the grandma, that that she said she only remembered just a little bit. So I'd like to think that they do remember something, because again, you know, that he's established that he doesn't understand why, you know, he's been obsessed with this town after the time skip. So I'd like to think, you know, they ask each other their names, and then of course they ask where they're from, and then maybe he realizes, oh, maybe that's why I was, you know, so obsessed with this place, was because, you know, I've been looking for you for so long for some reason. But then again, that's just me, like the optimist in me.
I think it could end up, you know, happy just, even without them remembering, like, because it's not like they're like, if I believe that, like, if two people are meant to be together based on that red string of fate, that regardless of how many times you have to reset a relationship based on memory things, that it will work out. Like, these two had chemistry when they were, you know, going back and forth and switching bodies from the first place, and so I'd like to believe that they end up happy together, even if they don't get the memories back.
Yeah, that's what
I mean. Lux put it pretty well. It doesn't. In the end, it really doesn't matter. Because they know they're meant to be together. So, yeah.
Yeah, Coolidger followed up what I said perfectly.
Yeah. So, numbered score. What would you give your name?
Right now, I have it as a 9. I don't know if I'll change it to an 8. It's tough, but for now, I think I'll just. I respect it enough that I'll just leave it there for now.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it's Makoto Shinkai's most polished film to date overall, so I'm definitely just going to keep it as a 9. I think 9 is... It's a very, very good anime film. I think there are a couple flaws that keep it from being a perfect 10, but I do think it's well worth watching.
I gave it a solid 7. I think 5 Centimeters is still my favorite Shinkai film, but, like... It's probably one of his better films. Definitely, like, if it... On the scale of, like, his best being 5 Centimeters and, like, his weakest being The Place Promised in Our Early Days, I'd put it near the top.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, I actually haven't seen 5 Centimeters yet, and I've heard a lot of people talk about it. I probably should really see it. Everybody says it's as good as it is.
I think that one's the really divisive one for Shinkai.
Yeah.
I'm not a fan of that personally.
Yeah.
Huh.
Maybe it's because I watched it too late, but yeah.
That was the first film I saw from him, and I saw it when I was like 11 years old, I think.
That was the first film a lot of people saw from him, because that was kind of his breakout film.
Yeah.
Okay. As for me, like I said, I originally gave it a 10, but when I really think about it, I don't think it's perfect. If I had to give it a score, it would probably be a 9, you know, with decimals, maybe like a 9.3 or something. It was a terrific film, and I will most definitely be buying it for my collection. I think it's a great romance, and I had a lot of fun with it.
Yeah, I've even debated on going out to see it again.
I think it's worth a second view, if you enjoyed it as much. I mean, if you give it a 9, then I can assume you enjoyed it. That you enjoyed it quite a lot.
Yeah.
So,
I think I'd put it in my top tier for enjoyment.
Nice. So yeah, it's worth a second viewing if you haven't seen it already, or if you want to see the sub version or the dub version, depending on what you saw previously. But I guess it's up to you. Okay, cool. So that's our first discussion. Our second point of the of our Sugoi Saturdays this month is talking about Anime Strike. As we all know, that the anime season just started about 2 weeks ago, maybe. And unfortunately, Sentai Filmworks is signed a deal with the devil. And now it's with Amazon.
Father,
through
why have you forsaken me?
Yes. You know, the power of Christ compels you. You know, so, you know, they dropped like 6 or 7 plus different show titles that they now own. And they're exclusively streaming on Anime Strike, which we all know you have to be a Prime member to have, which you don't necessarily have to pay the straight up $99, but you still have to pay, you know, a certain amount a month plus the $5 for Anime Strike. So, and lately, since the Funimation Crunchyroll partnership, you know, Sentai hasn't really been getting a lot of shows, let alone quality shows. You know, before that, because they got things like Food Wars and Monster Musume Gate and whatnot, but those are, in my opinion, quality shows. But, you know, and then after the Funimation Crunchyroll thing, they got, you know, things like Classicaloid, you know.
And I thought that was poor awful. Classicaloid.
Hey, second season, though.
Yeah, that'll be hype.
Yeah, Jesus, what is the deal with that? What are your guys' thoughts on what's happening with Anime Strike? Do you really think that Amazon, for the giant that they are, do you really think that they could cause a monopoly in the anime industry for the West?
I don't think they're going to, like, dominate over Crunchyroll or Funimation or anything. Like, I've seen a lot of people actually overreact to this. Like, oh, Amazon's just, like, destroying Crunchyroll this season. Like, motherfucker, Crunchyroll has Attack on Titan. Like, that's more important than literally every other anime combined, probably.
And My Hero Academia.
And My Hero
in terms
Academia,
of stuff airing this
which
season.
Which is another super
airing this season.
It's like, Crunchyroll and Funimation are fine. They'd probably have more shows if it weren't for Attack on Titan being such a huge get on its own. But I don't know. I'm not afraid, and I don't even dislike the fact that there's another sort of, like, anime streaming platform. It's just the double paywall is just too great, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
And I was okay with it last year when Amazon, they had the, for their Prime Video, they had the No Automata shows, which was just a bunch of bullshit, but Kabaneri the Iron Fortress, which was a big deal when that came out. I was fine with
poor
that.
Poor battery.
Fucking more like bad Uri. Yeah, that was fine because that's just a part of Amazon Prime, and like the $10 or $11 per month I think is fine because Amazon Prime has so many benefits that it's just, you know, I'm fine with paying that much. But now you have an extra $5 on top of that, and it's just, I'm not a fan of that personally.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Roger, what do you think?
I have a bit of a problem with Amazon Strike in that the quality, like, you know, I know a lot of folks complained about, like, Funimation's, like, quality, and I do think that the brightness on the video quality was a bit too light, but, you know, I watched my stuff on VHS tapes. I can tolerate low quality. But even I notice that Amazon Strike has some pretty weak quality for some of these shows. Like, I was trying to watch Psychono Flat Episode 0, and I was just coming off the Crunchyroll for Season 1, and I noticed, like, the quality drop immediately in the video. So I hope, like, in the future, they'll be able to, like, fix that and make it look better. I've been told that Bahamut Season 2, actually, looks pretty good on the service, which is good to know.
That's interesting.
But I'm told that all their other shows don't.
Because I know a lot of... Okay, really? That's interesting, just because I've, you know, not to interrupt you, but I've heard a lot of people say that Amazon is better in that regard because of their encoding and how their videos work and whatnot, as compared to Crunchyroll, I mean.
I was getting...
Because that's one of the big things, big criticisms of Crunchyroll is their video player.
I was getting mad pixely on that episode of Psychono, so I don't know.
Yeah, and I know there's some advantages, I guess, to it. What I heard and I think I saw is that you can changed the font and the size and I think even the color of the subtitles in the videos, can't you?
I did not try that out.
Yeah, I think I saw that on Anime Strike's Twitter feed, as I believe is where I saw it. And I thought that was actually pretty interesting because I know, you know, a lot of these shows are obviously all through Sentai Filmworks, and Sentai Filmworks is, you know, infamously known for its yellow, you know, subtitles as compared to everybody else who uses just the plain white. So I guess that's kind of interesting, I mean, in my opinion at least, because like I said, a lot of people hate that from Sentai Filmworks.
Though interestingly enough, Rage of Bahamut is a Funimation property.
Yeah. That's another big one. It's like, can they just take, you know, whatever the hell they want if they have enough money?
Yeah, Amazon's loaded.
Straight off.
Yeah. So, and I guess, you know, my personal theory of it is that, you know, Sentai saw an opportunity, especially after what's happened with Funimation and Crunchyroll. They're like, okay, we need to do something or else we are screwed. And I think they either went to Amazon. I don't know if Amazon went to them. It's kind of hard telling. But obviously a deal has been struck where, you know, Sentai is getting quite a bit of cash to license these titles for home video, while obviously Amazon is able to stream them. And that's probably, you know, because I don't think I've ever seen a season where Sentai gets more shows than, like, Funimation or whatever. Because they got, like, you know, it's like 7+ shows. A lot of them are, again, shows that a lot of people are excited for. Like, I think Lux was excited for Sagrada Reset.
Which is fucking awful.
Oh, it is?
Yes! Well, that's the worst fucking show this season. I'm so fucking mad.
Wait, you were expecting it to be good?
What have I done?
Ooh.
I thought you were going into
okay,
it.
Okay, so and
to hate
I was
it.
Excited for
wait, what?
For Armed Girls Machiavellism, and I liked that one. So, and then what was the other one? Shit, I think I have them. Oh, Recreators. I don't know about everybody who, if anyone saw Recreators yet, I thought that was actually pretty
that
good.
Was, oh.
That's an Aniplex title though.
Recreators was good. That like Ald Noah Zero type font was giving me Vietnam flashbacks.
Oh my god. I can't think of any let's see. Trying to find what the hell was the other thing that they grabbed
Don
that
Machi.
I wanted to watch. Oh yeah, well that is one, yeah.
They got that they got the not ReZero show.
Yeah. And that one's not bad.
What's that one called again?
Remora Zero.
I might have to go to my end. Oh yeah. Are you talking about the one with the blonde girl with the green bow? No, I'm thinking of something else. Let me go to my anime list while you guys keep talking about this.
Yeah, they got Anonymous Noise as well. I haven't seen that one.
Yeah.
That's pretty bad.
Oh, I've heard mixed things.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So the one of them that I was thinking of was the Roku Denashi Majutsu Koshi. To
bastard instructor.
Your Japanese is really
yeah,
bad.
Bastard instructor.
Akashic Records, whatever.
Yeah, and the other one I'm thinking of is Love Tyrant, but I think that's on Crunchyroll.
Both of those
Akashic Records also is on Crunchyroll.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right, because I just watched it the other day. You're
if
right.
I was Takai's Japanese teacher,
and I'm loving Love Tyrant. You know, I'm actually pretty darn good at reading Japanese.
Hey.
I just don't care at this point. You don't know me. Ooh.
I think I do. But let's
speaking of Love Tyrant, though, anime of the season, just going to throw that out there.
Dude, I love it so far. I think it's hilarious.
It's amazing.
Roger, huh?
I've only seen, like, I technically haven't seen anything from this season yet.
Me neither.
Yeah.
But anyway, Amazon Strike, whatever. It's cool.
Amazon Strike, yeah. Anime Strike.
Three strikes are out.
Anime Prime.
Yeah. I mean, you can already tell that they don't give a shit. I mean, look at their freaking logo. I could make that in 30 seconds in Photoshop.
When you think of anime, tell me what you think about Crunchyroll, Funimation, Sentai Filmworks. If anyone fucking thinks about Amazon Prime, you don't know anime. That's all I'm going to say about that, actually.
Yeah.
Well, they want to change that.
Well, yeah, they're trying. It still feels like it's a 2-on-1 handicap, though. I know, I get why Sentai is going for it, because they got to try and match the unfair partnership of Crunchyroll and Funimation, but...
I mean, and now they have a place where people can pay to access their dubs as well, because usually Sentai Filmworks dubs are never available unless you actually buy the DVD sets or Blu-ray sets.
On the other hand, those are too expensive, so as long as those continue to be well-priced, I'm not too bad off.
You know, for example, like High School of the Dead was like on Amazon or Anime Strike's front page. You know, you can watch the dub. So I guess that's another thing, because, you know, Sentai never really had their own exclusive streaming place like Crunchyroll, and Funimation had their own exclusive streaming thing. I guess Sentai, they have some kind of deal with like the Anime Network, right? But does anybody ever really use that?
It's weird, because I have the thing, I have Anime Network, and I've had Anime Network connected to my cable for, like, over a decade now, because I remember I used to watch it as a kid, but, like, the video quality on that, I'm not too picky about video quality, but watching that on a big screen TV, and seeing, like, 360p, or, like, no, it has to be, like, 240 or something, it's like a low-res YouTube video from, like, 2007, it just feels so wrong.
Yeah, see, I've had it on mine as well, but I could never access it because you had to pay for it. One of the categories was Super Happy Fun Time.
Yeah, it was Super Happy Fun Time, Girl Power, Action Zone.
Yeah, yeah. Super Happy Fun Time. Why would they do that? That's just enforcing stereotypes, goddammit.
nothing but reruns of Aremo all the time. Super Happy Fun
Time. Hey, that's Aniplex, you bastard. What, emo? You're talking about, right?
I think Full Metal Panic Fumofu is in Super Happy Fun Time.
Really? That's a Funimation one, I think, now.
Yeah, no, back in the day it was ADV, and that's where I saw it.
Yeah, ADV, yep. Yep, because Chris Pratt, Chris Patton and Lucy Christian and all them, yeah. But yeah, I think Anime Strike would actually be pretty darn successful. I mean, it's got one of the lowest price points that you can find on the internet for streaming anime at $4.99. The same price as Daisuke.net, but nobody uses that.
That's still a thing?
Yeah. Well, the only thing that they ever notably got was One Punch Man, if you remember that.
Well, Daisuke was We Got One Punch Man site.
And that was it.
That was it. That was it, yeah. So... it's at a solid price point, and if they can get their video quality under control, you know, and then you have the ability to change subs to whatever the hell you want, you know, that sounds pretty good to me. It really doesn't sound too bad, but again, like I've stated before, you know, there's just way too many services now, and people are going to start having to choose. I mean, Netflix and Hulu aren't really big ones. Hulu's practically pulled out at this point.
Yeah.
But, yeah, Amazon's not making it easy, and I'm kind of scared for the future.
The double paywall always turns people off. Like, it doesn't matter what the price point is. It's double paywall always turns people off. I think it would be
the thing
cool
is, I'm not... Oh, did you have anything to add?
Yeah, if they had, like, a thing where if you were a Prime member, you just got it, and then anybody who wasn't a Prime member could have an account for, you know, $12-$15 a month or whatever, I think that'd be totally cool.
Yeah, see, that's probably this. I think the issue here is that, I mean, Amazon can probably afford to do this by themselves because they already did it last year before they actually launched Anime Strike fully. But I think the problem is, like, the $4.99 second paywall, I think that's just Sentai Filmworks. That's their cut there. I think that's why they have it. So I'm not really sure how they can, reduce the cost while making it beneficial for both parties.
I'm glad you actually brought that up, because I was actually going to mention that they're basically treating this like, because what Amazon calls it is channels, like HBO channel and Starz channel. Like, to be able to access that stuff, you need Prime, plus you need to pay for that channel as well. And, you know, to me, it didn't make any sense for them to do this for the anime, because they practically outright own it. But then again, like you said, this is probably Sentai's cut. Or at least 50% of it, you know.
Yeah. I mean, I would love nothing
more. No, it's just
for
all
this
of Sentai's cut. They only get the $5 out of it.
Yeah.
Here you go, Sentai.
I mean, I would love nothing more for this just to be like a part of Amazon Prime, but Amazon Prime already has so many benefits that I don't think they can really afford to add like an entire new service to it, because you already have Twitch connectivity, you already have like free shipping for 2 days, you know, you have all these great benefits. And if it's just like the $4.99 on its own, or even if they raise it to like $6.99, say, I'm not sure if that'd just be worth it for Amazon to keep doing it.
Yeah. I'm personally, the only thing I'm still scared of is that they're just not going to care, and they're just still going to take things and kind of treat them like crap.
Yeah.
That's just kind of like my one thing that I'm scared of. But with Sentai there, as if anybody knows about their premium editions and, you know, whatnot, they do treat series with respect and quality. And, you know, I mean, sure, their menus aren't as nice as Funimation's, but, you know, what are you going to do? So at least Sentai's there for the people that do care about anime, which, as compared to Amazon, which I don't think they give a crap about anime, as compared to the people at Funimation and the people at Crunchyroll.
Yeah.
So that's just like, that's the one thing that kind of frightens
me. Yeah,
those companies
I think
are all very clearly run by anime fans. You can tell by their social media, even.
Yeah,
I think Amazon not caring is a very fair concern, because if you remember back in fall 2016, they were supposed to premiere The Great Passage, but they didn't premiere that until Anime Strike launched in January 2017.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, that's just one of those things you really got to keep a tab on. You know, I've told a lot of people, and a lot of people have said this in general, that they are using the Amazon feedback thing, and they're trying to contact Amazon to at least separate it from Prime. But personally, I don't know if I'll ever see that happening. The only thing that I can see is possibly them just dropping the $4.99 altogether and just saying, you know, just, you know, you just get Prime. And that's it. Just because I don't really see them trying to break it away from Prime, because that's their main goal, is to get more Prime members. So, anyone final thoughts on that at all?
If there is one positive thing that I can say about this, I at least appreciate... I'm sorry if you can hear thunder in the background. I at least appreciate that they have, like, a handful of shows. Because my problem with alternate streaming websites like the Anime Network, or even worse, fucking Netflix, they only get, like, one or two shows per season. Whereas, like... Like, Crunchyroll and Funimation would get 95% of the seasonal anime. Mm-hmm. And then the next 5% is distributed across, like, 7 different platforms. So there's always that one show that, you know, you just got a torrent. Just because you want to watch it. But at least with Amazon Anime Strike, there's, like, what, 10 anime or something on there?
Yeah, at least.
I can, you know, that's kind of cool, at least, you know. Now you can have a second platform where there's a bunch of stuff instead of just having to go everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that's the thing I think with Hulu and Netflix, and I mean, a majority of their stuff is just, you know, stuff from either Sentai Filmworks or Funimation or Viz or Aniplex. Because it kind of feels like they've backed out a little bit. Sure, Netflix, I would say Netflix is kind of the, you know, a little bit different, just because they've got their quote unquote original series. Like they did with Pretty Precure, and I think Voltron, I think, as well. I could be mistaken. And then, of course, Little Witch Academia is another one that you can think of. And Seven Deadly Sins, which now they're having Funimation deal with the video release rights, you know, or home video release rights. So Netflix is kind of its own beast altogether, I guess. But really, they don't ever, you know... They're not really getting anything exclusively anymore, you know. Yeah. Little Witch Academia was just because it was a special project at first, and I don't know if anybody else could pick it up due to, you know, probably extreme licensing fees. You know, who knows?
Well, this season they have the new Goro Taniguchi show, the CG one, ID Zero.
I've not heard of this.
Okay. Yeah, neither have I.
Well, that's because no one watched it.
I mean, I know last year Netflix got Ajin, but I think Sentai is about to release that one.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah.
Who has Kuro Makuro? Is that Pony Canyon?
Yeah.
Oh, God, I forgot they existed here. Pony Canyon. You know, they've got things like, what, Etotama, and I think they also have Sound Euphonium.
Yeah, and Roka. Poor Roka.
Yeah, Roka. Oh my god.
Oh no.
Rip.
Roka just never gets a break.
Everyone needs to watch Hinako Note this season to support Passione.
Hinako Note is good, at least.
Okay. Well, I think that was a solid hour and 6 minute discussion.
Nice.
Yeah.
It's beautiful.
Everyone with Amazon Prime, be sure to change your, everyone with Anime Strike, be sure to change your font to Comic Sans.
Jesus. I'd vomit.
Dear Sentai Filmworks, we would like our North American release of Chihaya Furuke. Thanks, bye.
Actually, before we end, I'm so glad you said North American. Because of Anime Strike, a lot of international fans can't access it as compared to, say, Crunchyroll.
Yeah. That's also a thing.
Mr. Canadian over there.
I don't have Amazon Prime anyway, so I don't care.
Well, fortunately, but I think Crunchyroll is trying to help with that, because there's... I forgot which anime it is, but I know there's at least one anime this season that's on Anime Strike, but Crunchyroll got the rights to stream it outside of the U.S.
Funky.
Huh. Well, that's good. I mean, at least they're... See, and again, that just goes back to the thing where they actually care.
Yeah.
You know, they're like, yes, we want people to see this. You know, I've seen a lot of European fans, especially in the U.K., of all places... complain about not getting it, but I think Anime Lab is for like Australia and whatnot, I believe, and I know they're getting a lot of stuff that Amazon Prime has been getting for at least, you know, that specific region for international streaming. Don't know about Europe though. So it's kind of a clusterfuck of a situation right now. So.
We'll see.
Before we go, what's your favorite show this season?
Love Tyrant. Greatest of all time.
Centric Family Season 2.
I still don't even know
what that
is.
Even though I haven't watched it yet. That's already my favorite.
Kabuki Boo.
Kabuki,
oh, that, I don't even know what that is.
Is that one any good?
I didn't watch it.
I haven't seen that one yet. Also, honorable mention though, World End. I love that one because the main girl wears a witch hat.
Yeah, you have a fetish for witch hats.
It's not a fetish.
It's a fetish. Don't lie.
No. I just think it's like aesthetically pleasing.
That's why he's angry about Delphox. Delphox doesn't have a witch hat.
Yeah, fuck you, Delphox. What a piece of shit.
Probably My Hero Academia for me. I'll be the mainstream guy. Oh. Fuck me, I love that show. But I do love Tyrant as well. It's beautiful. Especially how they simplify her to just like a bald head with like one lock of hair.
Oh my god, the animation for that show is so good.
It's like when the animation budget dries out. Just a picture of that.
Let's just remove their hair. Perfect strategy.
Yeah, just a generic smiley face. Okay. Well, anyway, I think that is Sugoi Saturdays, everybody. Again, thank you very much for watching. Thanks, everybody who have come today and dealt with my bad internet. But I think we found a suitable solution Sugoi-able. To that with Discord instead.
Yeah, you actually sounded good for this whole thing.
Oh, my gosh.
What a compliment.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to put that in my little notebook tonight. I was complimented.
And then a girl will wake up in your body and see that the next day.
Yeah, really. Try to get me a... Hopefully she'll try to get me a girlfriend while I'm here, too. QQ. Well, anyway, thanks, guys, for coming on. I appreciate it, as always.
Yeah,
it was great.
Mm-hmm. Now, that sounded sarcastic. Holy shit.
Everything he says.
Oh, yeah, I just love this.
It's like, I'm not a fan. I'm just here at an obligation.
Well, to be fair, this was actually my idea doing this.
Yeah, you wanted to do your name pretty bad.
Yeah.
And no, I think it was a good discussion. I think it was definitely worth talking about. It was a good movie. It was the anime event of the 2010.
Makoto Shinkai, the new Miyazaki.
Anime was a mistake.
See, they say that every time, like, a director comes out with a new movie. Yeah. The new Miyazaki. It used to be Hosoda when Boy and the Beast came out. You know, now we're going to Shinkai.
Wait, are we still recording?
Hosoda's been a thing for a while.
Did you stop your recording, Roger?
No.
Oh.
No, we're just shit talking at the end here.
Oh, okay.
Okay, now we can. Yep, now
Welcome
we can
to
end
shit
it.
Posting well, thank Saturdays.
You. Yeah, shit posting Saturdays. I'll have to make that the thumbnail. Okay. Well, thanks everybody so much for watching, and we'll catch you next month. Bye, bye, everybody.
See ya.
Sayonara, Zatsubou Sensei.
Bye.